Allah is my heart's speech. Your mercy is what I beseech. Keep in my heart your remembrance, and in your deen allow me to advance. Help me in my quest. Permit me to pass the ultimate test. Help me in my quest. Permit me to pass the ultimate test.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillah wa salatu wa salamu ala nabiyihi wa mustafa, Sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man wala. Brothers and sisters, welcome to another edition of your program, Ask Huda. Our contact informations, as usual, beginning with area code, are 002-0238-555-248-249, and alternatively, area code 002-011-2500-8679, and the email address is ask@huda.tv. We'll be more than happy to start taking your calls and concerns. Meanwhile, I have a couple of pending questions. The first question is, is about from Brother Muhammad from the KSA, who said, people used to say, especially in Mecca, in Ramadan, that the reward is multiplied into 70 to 7 million times. Is that correct? And also, he has a second question. We'll answer it after answering this question, inshallah. First of all, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam specified the virtues of praying in Mecca or in Medina in Ramadan or in any other time. He says, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, first of all, a single prayer that you may offer in Al-Masjid Al-Haram is better than 100,000 prayer that you may offer anywhere else. So each prayer, and that applies to the fard prayer and to the voluntary prayers, each single prayer you offer is better reward than 100,000 prayer anywhere else. Then he also said in one hadith to Humayd, may Allah be pleased with her, and he said to another woman of his companions who was not able to perform Hajj with him, he said, whenever it is Ramadan, just perform Umrah, because performing Umrah in Ramadan is equivalent to performing Hajj. And there is another riwayah, narration, in which he says, performing Umrah in Ramadan is equivalent to performing Hajj along with me, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this is the mentioned reward as far as praying in the Haram, staying in Mecca or Medina. And particularly in Mecca, the reward is 100,000 times for each prayer, whether in Ramadan or outside Ramadan. Yes, in Ramadan, Allah multiplies the reward. We don't know the exact figure as how many times, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opens the doors of heaven and closes the doors of hell and multiplies the reward. There is a weak hadith that says that each fard will be rewarded for 70 fard in any other time, and each nafila will be rewarded as if it is a fard prayer or a fard act of worship, but this is a weak hadith. We need to keep in mind that الأرض لا تقدس أحدا. This is a statement of the scholars. The earth would not simply make anyone holy or sacred. You may be staying in Mecca, but if the person is wicked and he is staying in Mecca, the person is not praying, then being in Mecca, being a neighbor to the Haram, next door to the Haram, would not do you any good. As a matter of fact, you'll be blameworthy more than others. Okay? So it depends on what do you do in Mecca, what do you do in Medina, what do you do whenever you are in these sacred places. I've come across some people, especially in Ramadan, that they book the seats in the Haram and they stay from morning until after Asr. Then all of a sudden those people are gone. They are not gone because they are not interested in staying. I realize that this is their job. They book seats so that they sell their places to others. who bargain with them and they come late so that they stay right before Maghrib to witness Maghrib and Isha and Taraweeh. So that is a business that they do. And they occupy other places and people come and try to find a place to pray. And there may be an empty spot, but the person have booked it. For whom? For whoever will pay. It is unfortunate. Brother Muhammad's second question is it allowed that a woman can take some pills to delay the period in order to be able to perform Umrah? It is permissible. But when it comes to medication, we normally refer the questioner to their doctors, to the specialists. If your doctor said it is safe, have you tried it before and it is safe for you, and it does the purpose, then it is permissible. That if you want to, but it is not necessary. Because if a woman intended to perform Umrah or to perform Hajj, and she happened to experience her period, that is something which she could not do anything about it in the past, and that's why she would do everything other than performing tawaf. And whenever she's clean, she can perform tawaf. And the scholars say that if she's coming in a caravan or a group where she has to leave and she doesn't have an access to stay for extra more days in order to wait for the period to be over so that she can take ghusl and perform tawaf, in this case, she can still perform ghusl and do the tawaf and sa'i and go home. If your physician says it is safe, and if you tried it before and it is safe, then no problem. He can do that. Sister Huma Ahsan says, is it permissible for a woman to dye her hair if she is in a state of menstruation, as it is a state of impurity? Yes, it is permissible. No problem. The menstruation would not prevent a woman from dyeing her hair, waxing her hair, or doing the regular things that she would do. The menses would only stop the woman from praying, from fasting, from having an intimate relationship. And the intimate relationship here particularly refers to a complete sexual intercourse with her spouse. As Allah the Almighty says in Surah Al-Baqarah, يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْمَحِيضِ قل هو آدم فاعتزلوا النساء في المحيض ولا تقربوهن حتى يطهرن فإذا تطهرن فأتوهن من حيث أمركم الله إن الله يحب التوابين ويحب المتطهرين. This ayah was revealed to refute a very common misconception that people have inherited from the Jewish community in Medina, where they used to consider a menstruated woman as an impure thing. So they wouldn't let her cook for them, touch anything with her bare hands, because it automatically will turn to be impure as well. She would not share bed with the husband. She would not sit on the same sheet, on the same seat that the family members sit on. She would have special place as long as she is menstruated. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refuted that and said the only thing that should be avoided is فَاعْتَزِلُوا النِّسَاءَ فِي الْمَحِيضِ. Avoid having the sexual relationship with your woman while she is menstruated. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam demonstrated in more than one occasion. Aisha radiallahu anha narrated that she would be in her menses, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would share the meal with her, and he would wait for her to take a bite from a chunk of meat, then he would take a bite from the same spot, place his mouth, his teeth on the same spot that she had eaten from. Similarly, whenever she drinks from a glass or a cup, he would drink from the same spot, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sister Juwairia from Uganda.
Yes, Juwairia.
Yeah, Sister Juwairia, you're live on Ask Huda. Go ahead.
I have two questions, Sheikh. Mm-hmm. The first question is, how is it an innovation? Yani, if I read Quran like I read Surah Al-Baqarah and I finish and I make dua, I heard that it's like an innovation. My intention is to read and make dua if I want something, but how is it an innovation? Because it's Quran and there is nothing different from there. My second question is, if I want to perform Hajj and I cannot afford to pay for a mahram, in my country there is this traveling like in groups, like 10 people. So they divide you like 2, 2, 2, 2. So in that case, you don't have to pay for a mahram. Is this halal? Yani, can my Hajj be yani, accepted? Is this haram or halal?
Okay.
Those are two questions I have.
Thank you. Sister Juwairia, barakallahu fiki. Making dua or supplication after every righteous deed is permissible, including reciting Quran. So when you recite Quran, then you make dua, that is permissible. But it is not something that you have to do on a regular basis. Similarly, I mentioned before, even in the prayer, if people make dua after the prayer, I do not see it as an innovation, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to Mu'adh ibn Jabal, لا تدعن دبر كل صلاة أن تقول اللهم أعني على ذكرك وشكرك وحسن عبادتك. And this is dua, saying astaghfirullah 3 times after the prayer is dua. But when people make this as an inseparable part from the prayer, that they should do every prayer, to the point that you see people are afraid to get up, to be dismissed before the imam makes the dua and they join him and they say ameen, this is an act which is a typical innovation. But every once in a while, whenever you pray and you want to make dua, as permissible. Whenever you recite Quran, then you conclude your recitation by making dua, that is permissible. You give in a charity and you ask Allah to accept it from you and to pardon you your sins, that is permissible. Ibrahim alayhi salam in Surah Al-Baqarah, ayah number 127. Allah the Almighty told us, وَإِذْ يَرْفَعُ إِبْرَاهِيمُ الْقَوَاعِدَ مِنَ الْبَيْتِ وَإِسْمَاعِيلُ رَبَّنَا تَقَبَّلْ مِنَّا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ ربنا واجعلنا مسلمين لك ومن ذريتنا أمة مسلمة لك وأرنا مناسكنا وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم ربنا وابعث فيهم رسولا منهم يتلو عليهم آياتك ويعلمهم الكتاب والحكمة ويزكيهم إنك أنت العزيز الحكيم. You see how many supplication Prophet Ibrahim and his son Ismail, peace be upon them, made when they were raising the foundations of the Kaaba. And this is a righteous deed. Okay? Barakallahu fikum. The second question of Sister Juwairia from Uganda. Performing Hajj without a male mahram for the travel agent. They appoint every two together, even though if she doesn't have a mahram, she still can go in a group. And that goes back to the same opinion or view which is adopted by many of the scholars, including Shafi'iyya, that a woman who is performing Hajj in a group or in a safe company, with a safe company in a caravan, that is permissible only for Hajj and for Umrah. But they still agree with the vast majority of the Muslim jurists that it is not permissible for a woman to travel the travel distance without having a male mahram of her or having a husband. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Sister Juwairia, said, وَلِلَّهِ عَلَى النَّاسِ حِجُّ الْبَيْتِ مَنِ اسْتَطَاعَ إِلَيْهِ سَبِيلًا. So Al-Hajj is the fifth pillar and it is a conditional ibadah, provided you can afford it. For everybody, affordability is physical and financial. And for women, there is another condition, which is having an available mahram who can travel with her. So for those who say it is not permissible for a woman to travel for any journey, including Hajj or Umrah, without having a male mahram of her, they say she will be committing a sin but the Hajj will be valid otherwise. But she have committed the sin of traveling without the mahram. And as for those who say there is an exemption, like not every woman can have a mahram for her journey. So if she travels with a safe company to perform Hajj or Umrah, that is permissible. So that's why they refer to this opinion. Assalamu alaikum. Brother Muhammad from the KSA.
How are you, Sheikh?
I'm fine, alhamdulillah. Thank you for asking.
Okay, Sheikh, I have two questions. One is, is it allowed to cut hair or nails during the Janaba period? And the second question is, in Makkah, when I used to go there, the people as a group, they are praying in the road, but then in the inside, the near the haram, because of the rush inside the mosque, So is it counted as exactly the same reward? These are the two questions, Sheikh.
Okay. Jazakallahu khairan. First of all, it is permissible to cut your nails and your hair while you are in a state of janabah. No problem. Secondly, we're supposed to line up our rows and lines behind the imam when the iqama is called. And there's supposed to be some time between the adhan and the iqama so that people could draw as close as possible to the imam. We're not supposed to leave those gaps between the rows or within the same line. أَتِمُّ الصَّفَّ الْأَوَّلَ ثُمَّ الَّذِي يَلِيهِ. We're supposed to complete the first row, then the second, then the third, until all the rows are complete. What we see is, even though weather may not be hot, but people are coming late, so they want to catch the prayer. So they pray far away from the haram, far away from the jama'ah. And there is like a couple hundred meters between them and the jama'ah. People are passing and crossing in front of them. That is not permissible. You draw as much as possible so that you fill in the gaps and you complete the rows in order to attend the jama'ah. Thank you, Brother Muhammad from the KSA. We have a question about al-khul'ah. The brother says that his wife demanded khul'a, and he agreed, provided that she would give him back his gifts, the jewelry which he gave her, and she did. Then they decided to go back to each other, so he embraced her sexually before her period had started. So is that permissible or not? How many times we say, whenever you are involved in certain activities, you must be aware of the Islamic rules and regulations, the Sharia part with regards to your segment. If you're a merchant, you have to know what is halal and haram in selling, in buying, in borrowing, in lending, in different types of investment. You know, what a shame that somebody is investing for 20, 30 years. He's making, a lot of violations. And he simply says, I didn't know. So he has an accountant. And he has an advisor. And a counselor. And a lawyer. He doesn't want to mess up with the law. Or with the IRS. With the tax. And with the government. But he is messing up with Allah and with the rights of the poor, with what is halal and haram. Whenever a couple get married, they are supposed to ask before the act, before they get married, how to get married properly. What are the pillars of the marriage, and how can we make sure that our wedding is valid? Not after they get married. One brother who invited me for to talk to him and to his wife and reconcile, I just realized that this person married his wife and she was still already married to somebody else, but she broke up with him and she left, and she told him that I'm not married. So he married her. Even if a woman is divorced, it is not permissible to propose to a woman who's divorced during the iddah, even if the husband is dead 4 months and 10 days. It is not permissible to reveal to this woman or to her guardian that I'm interested in marrying you. You have to respect that this person was married this woman one day. So you have to wait for the iddah. Then after the iddah, you can propose. It is not permissible. So I told him that, you know what, both of you, your relationship is not valid. Your relationship so far is adultery, other than the fact that you did not know, so there is a shubha or a doubt. But now, after you guys have known, this is not permissible. You have to separate from each other. Again, she said, well, I don't have anywhere else to go. I don't have another house. It doesn't matter. That can be sorted out. Not because you don't have another place to go. You don't have a family to take you now. You live with somebody who is not lawful for you. It's not permissible. A person who gave khul'a to his wife should understand that the khul'a is not divorce. Have a different ahkam than the talaq, as I will explain inshallah in a little bit. Assalamu alaikum. Abu Ubaidah from Sudan. Assalamu alaikum. Abu Ubaidah, go ahead please. Are you still on the line?
Yes.
Go ahead, please.
No, I'm not over there. My name is Lamin.
Okay, go ahead.
I'm asking about the ayah in the Quran that it says, "Do not take the non-believers, disbelievers as allies and of people." Does it mean that we don't have to get friends with them, or can you please explain that ayah for me? Thank you.
Got your question. Okay. So al-khul' is not a typical divorce. Al-khul' is a separation based on a compensation that you collected back your dowry, or lesser than that, your gifts, or whatever you guys agree to. If you agree to a certain amount, and she pays you, or she promises to pay you, then you give her khul'a, even if you say you're divorced, but this is khul'a, even if you pronounce the word divorce. But this divorce is not a typical divorce, because you separated from each other for a compensation. She compensated you for that. She said, I want out, and here is much whatever you guys agreed to. In this case, she is absolutely separated from you, and it is not permissible to take her back, even within the iddah, without a new marriage contract, and without her consent, and the consent of her guardian. Like you're marrying a woman from the scratch, because that is khul'a. So, just resuming having sexual relations with her, assuming that, okay, she is still in the iddah, and that was our first divorce, that was not divorce. That is not divorce. In the case of divorce, as Allah Almighty says, الطلاق مرتان فإمساك بمعروف أو تسريح بإحسان. Then, in the waiting period, which is والمطلقات يتربصن بأنفسهن ثلاثة قروء, the three periods or the 3 months for a woman who does not experience the period is the waiting period after the first and the second divorce. If the husband decides otherwise, decides to reconcile, to take his wife back, then in this case he's free to do that without having to process a new marriage contract, without even the consent of her guardian, even without her consent, because she is still officially married to him. Okay? That's why in Surah At-Talaq, Allah the Almighty says, لا تخرجوهن من بيوتهن ولا يخرجن إلا أن يأتين بفاحشة مبينة. So in this case, the divorced woman will stay in the same house with the ex-husband who just divorced her until the iddah is over. When the iddah is over, the man would not have an access to take her back to his marriage life. What if they both want to reconcile? after 3-4 months later, they want to reconcile. How many times he divorced her? Only once or two times? Okay, in this case, it is permissible to propose to her from the beginning. And the guardian agrees. Then you agree to a new dowry. And you process a new marriage contract with the presence of two male just witnesses, Muslim witnesses. So it's like you're marrying her from the scratch. That is exactly true. In the case of khula, once you agree to the khula from the beginning, that's called separation. And that will be baynunatun sura. Al-baynuna, there is talaqun ba'in. There is a minor or baynuna and a major baynuna. And the major baynuna where the husband would not have an access to take or remarry his ex-wife back. Unless if she marries somebody else. Why? Because he has consumed the three divorces. Allah the Almighty says, فَإِن طَلَّقَهَا فَلَا تَحِلُّ لَهُ مِن بَعْدُ حَتَّى تَنْكِحَ زَوْجًا غَيْرًا. خلاص, he divorced her three times. So in this case, he cannot simply take her back even if they want to get married from the scratch and he's willing to pay a new dowry. No, it's not up to you. مِن بَعْدِ أَن تَنْكِحَ فَلَا تَحِلُّ لَهُ مِن بَعْدُ حَتَّى تَنْكِحَ زَوْجًا غَيْرًا. Not unless if she marries another man. And that should not be arranged, pre-agreed to it. Rather, it should be done naturally. She marries somebody else. Then if the marriage didn't work out and he divorced her and the iddah is over, so her first ex-husband, if he wanted to marry her and she agrees to that, that is permissible. Okay? That is called baynunatun kubra. Talaq ba'in, irreversible. Baynunatun kubra. He cannot even take her back to his marriage life with a new marriage contract. Why? Because he consumed the three divorces. In the case of the khula, baynunatun matsura. It is irrevocable, but it can be revoked through processing a new marriage contract. Assalamu alaikum. Brother Ali from United Arab Emirates.
Ya Sheikh Muhammad Saleh, Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum Assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Brother Muhammad, Sheikh Muhammad, I have a question about zakah. And I just moved from United States. I got a job here in United Arab Emirates, so the money that was in my previous working, the company that I was working with, they have this 401k plan for me. And I realized that they deposited in my account because they asked to cash my 401k. It was around 12,000. So I wanted to know about the zakah, how should I pay it, about that money, because and it has been accumulating for 3.5 years now. So should I have to divide into those years and pay it? Or should I just wait and, you know, I mean, just, you know, do like one payment only?
Okay. I got your question, Brother Ali. For the 401k, you pay zakah only when you receive the money. And since you already received it, you pay zakah for it once. Only once. Then if this money stays with you for another lunar year, you pay zakah again next year on it. Whether that is the only amount that you possess, or if you happen to also earn other money, so you add the entire amount and you pay zakah on all your possession. Barakallahu feek, Brother Ali. May Allah make you prosper, make you wealthy from halal, and forgive us all our sins. Brothers and sisters, we'll take a short break and inshallah I'll be back in a couple of minutes. Please stay tuned.
Put Huda TV is pleased to announce the launching of its first mobile phone application on all iOS and Android-based devices. Browse your phone store for our new app under the name of Huda TV. Huda app delivers a bunch of amazing and versatile services to our fans and viewers worldwide. You can watch our live streaming on the move, surf our large archive of categorized articles, benefit from our daily supplications, Askar, that every Muslim should recite throughout the day. Just tap on any item of the Askar list and it will take you to the specific supplication it indicates to. Need to know the broadcast time of your favorite program? Just click to broadcast schedule for specific details. Huda app allows users to browse the gems of Huda TV website, where they can enjoy our telemedia services by watching thousands of video clips, plenty of audio clips featuring invocations, nasheeds, and audio themes of our favorite programs. Go back to the index page and check upon what is going on at Huda TV by visiting ever-updated Huda News. Get to know the profiles of Huda stars and never forget to tap on our behind the scenes button for exploring our backstage activities. It's also worthy to check upon Huda's pages on social media websites and enjoy our awesome posts and sharing. Download Huda TV's app now and live our world of authentic Islamically themed educational knowledge. Huda TV brings light to every smartphone.
Welcome to Cosmic Proof, the one and only program that leads you to the truth wherever it is, for my sake and your sake. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. And welcome back, brothers and sisters. Our first caller in the second segment is Sister Saba from Canada. Assalamu alaikum, Sister Saba.
Wa alaikum assalam, brother. How are you?
Fine, alhamdulillah. Thank you for asking.
Okay, brother, inshallah, by Allah's grace, we are inshallah going to Hajj this year.
MashaAllah, congratulations.
Shukran. And I have one question. So, I have two questions. Mm-hmm. My first question is, to take the maximum benefit of our time in Makkah and Medina, could you give us some advice? What are the things best to do to take the full benefit of this lifetime journey first?
Okay.
My second question is, my mother-in-law lives in India. And we live in Canada. She wanted to come in a group by herself, like with a huge group. She's 68 years old. And then she could join us in Makkah, and she could stay with us for the Hajj period. Is that permissible, or what is the ruling regarding that?
Okay.
And my third question is, my father-in-law has passed away. I have already done my Hajj. My husband is doing it for the first time, but I have done it at a very young age. So I was wondering that could I do it on behalf of my father?
Well, mashallah, very nice. How sweet.
I could do it on behalf of my father-in-law. I'm sorry, father-in-law.
Yeah, I understand. That's why I said that's okay. Very sweet.
And please make dua for us that make Allah make it easy and accept all our prayers. Jazakallah.
Ameen. May Allah bless you and your family and make it easy for you and for those who are planning on performing Hajj this year and accept it from them. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Brother Ahmed from the KSA.
Wa alaikum salam, Sheikh.
Alaikum salam. Welcome to the program. Go ahead, Akhi.
Sheikh, my question is, Allah says in the Quran, Surah Nisa, ayah 31. Allah says in the Quran, ayah 31, if you avoid major sins, then I forgive all your minor sins and admit in paradise. So what is the value of minor sins in Islam? Is there any value of minor sins in Islam?
If there is any value of what?
Is there any value of minor sins in Islam?
Major sins in Islam? Minor or major?
Yes.
Okay. Do you have any other questions? Okay. I think we had also another question from one brother, Ali. Oh, no, Abu Ubaidah from Sudan on the ayah. لا تتخذوا الذين اتخذوا دينكم هزوا ولعبا من الذين أوتوا الكتاب من قبلكم والكفار أولياء. In which Allah the Almighty says, O you believe, do not take those who mock at your religion, whether from the non-believers or from the people of the book, those who have been given the book before you, the Jews and the Christians, do not take them as awliya. What is the definition of the word awliya? Means awliya, plural of wali, which means support and guide or guard. So do not take them as your allies, as you support, that you rely on them. And there is, of course, big difference between taking some people as your support and having to deal with them justly and deal with them rightly, as Allah the Almighty says, لا ينهاكم الله عن الذين لم يقاتلوكم في الدين ولم يخرجوكم من دياركم أن تبروهم وتقسطوا إليهم. إن الله يحب المقسطين. And the following ayah explains this ayah which we had earlier. So now Allah the Almighty says, if non-Muslims, non-believers did not fight against you, did not wage war against you, did not assist the enemies of Islam against you, so there is no problem of dealing with them kindly, being kind to them. أن تبروهم وتقسطوا إليهم. We are commanded to be just even with the enemies. What about people who have not hurt us, who have not done any wrong to us? Simply they chose not to believe in our religion. Okay? Then in the following ayah, Surah Al-Mumtahana, ayah number 9, only Allah forbids you. إنما ينهاكم الله عن الذين قاتلوكم في الدين وأخرجوكم من دياركم وظاهروا على إخراجكم أن تولوهم ومن يتولهم فأولئك هم الظالمون. So of all the non-believers, whether of the people of the book or otherwise, that we are forbidden to be kind, to be friends with whom? With the enemies, those who fight against us, those who fight against Muslims, those who burn Muslims alive, those who burn their homes and their properties, those who expel and force them out of their homes, they are our enemies, no doubt. If you don't see it this way, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, those are the awliya of Allah. If you're not one of them, then you are one of the others. Okay? That is the meaning of taking somebody as awali or awliya, which is a plural of wali. Assalamu alaikum. Afrina from the case, say assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam.
Yeah?
Yeah, I have a question.
Yeah?
Yeah. Do we need to hear Alhamdulillah when someone sneezes, then say Ya Rahmatullah?
If the person who sneezed said Alhamdulillah in a heard voice, then you should say Ya Rahmatullah to him or to her.
And yeah. If we do not hear Alhamdulillah,
you don't say Ya Rahmatullah. So the person must say it out loud so that the audience or at least one of them would say Ya Rahmatullah. If he doesn't say it, or if he said it, that he did not say he said it. He did not say it in a heard voice. You don't say يرحمكم الله, because the hadith says وَإِذَا عَطُسَ فَحَمِدَ اللَّهَ شَمَّتَّهُ. If he sneezes and he says Alhamdulillah, then you tell him يرحمكم الله. Okay.
Okay.
جزاكم الله خير. Thank you, Sister Afina from the KSA. Sister Saba from Canada. how to make the best use of my time in Hajj, in Mecca and in Medina. It's been, alhamdulillah, our 10th year that we're doing a very interesting program for pilgrims who are going to perform Hajj from North America, from all the different states of the North America and Canada. And it has been very helpful. Why? Because people, when they figure out what they have to do beforehand and to prepare themselves spiritually and mentally for this job, for this task, they achieve it properly. Versus when people, they have no clue whatsoever. And they just show up. They already arrived to Jeddah airport, still dressed up in their clothes. And they ask, so what is next? What is next? You missed the miqat. So we started from the beginning with a big violation. And once they land in Mecca, they ask about the shops. Somebody told me that in this mall there is a very cheap shop. So every day, once the shops are open, they are shopping, shopping, shopping. What a waste. Isn't it permissible to shop while performing Hajj? No, it is permissible. Allah said, لِيَشْهَدُوا مَنَافِعَ لَهُمْ To witness benefits, trade, business, profiting, no problem. But not to waste this lifetime opportunity in shopping, in browsing, in going, especially nowadays, there are a lot of malls, a lot of shops, and it is very tempting. You feel yourself like you are downtown Manhattan, or you are in the Galleria. You know, I myself, I don't like that. I don't think this is the way I like Mecca when I saw it, years ago. Very classic, very ordinary place. You focus on your ibadah. But anyway, this is happening. Now, what am I supposed to do? Inshallah, I will share with you after this call. Assalamu alaikum. Sister Nada from Egypt.
Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
I have a question. I have a teacher in my school. She said that you're allowed to swear by the mushaf.
You're allowed to do what?
You're allowed to like take an oath by the mushaf. Like you could say one mushaf.
Okay.
Is that allowed?
Okay, got your question. If you're swearing to the Quran as the word of Allah, so it is one of his traits, it is permissible. Okay, but if you're swearing on the Quran as a copy and a hard copy or a cover and papers, that's not permissible. And obviously, I guess that when a person says, I swear to the Quran as the word of Allah, the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam forbade making or taking an oath to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he says, "Man kana halifan falyahlif billahi aw liyasmut." If you have to take an oath, then say wallahi or be quiet. So Sister Saba, the reason I mention about the courses that we start every year since Ramadan, we have conference calls where those who are nominated to perform Hajj attend the conference to learn exactly what they need to do step by step. From beginning to end. One of the very interesting things that, alhamdulillah, we promoted, and it is very, very productive and effective, the idea of finishing the Quran. So we raise the awareness of that indeed the good deeds will be doubled and multiplied in these sacred places, as I mentioned in the beginning of the program. Okay? So many of the scholars said it is not only limited to the prayer. It is rather expanded to cover all the good deeds. So let's finish the Quran. If you're staying in Medina for 5 days, if you recite 6 paras every day, you get to finish the Quran. If you're staying in Mecca for 6 days, 5 paras every day, you get to finish the Quran. Guess what? My goal was to make people busy with the Quran, especially when they sit in Al-Masjid Al-Nabawi, when they sit in Mecca in Al-Haram, and they enter the Haram with the intention of i'tikaf.
not to waste their time to occupy themselves with the recitation of the Quran instead of chit-chatting. As a result of that, I was very surprised to find out that many sisters have finished the Quran 2, 3, and 4 times while staying in Mecca and Medina in this very short period. Why? We have plenty of time. But this time could be simply consumed, burned. If you sit and chat with somebody in the haram, 2 hours. Between Dhuhr and Asr, 3 hours, gone. Then between Asr and Maghrib, gone. Then you get to know somebody so that you say, okay, I'm going to meet you after Asr. Well, let's go together to the haram. And talk and talk and talk and talk. What a waste. Talking, unnecessary talk. Shopping, unnecessary shopping. You know, if you have to shop, postpone it to the last few days before you leave. Or if you're staying for a day or two in Jeddah. Whatever is there is in your country. You know, focus mainly on your ibadah. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, من حج فلم يرفث ولم يفسق رجع كيومي ولدته أمه. He who performs hajj and avoids all types of sins and sexual relations shall return home as pure as the same day he or she were born. Pure, sinless. One of the things that I advise you to do is always carry some change in your pocket or your purse. You know, those workers in the haram, they are eligible for sadaqah. Make sure that as long as you're walking in the morning, in the evening, 5, 5, 5, 10, 10, 10, 50, based on your capacity, because the reward of sadaqah will be double or multiplied in this place as well. Assalamu alaikum. Sister Sari from Egypt.
Alaikum salam. How are you, Sheikh?
Fine, alhamdulillah. Thank you for asking.
I have 2 questions.
Mm-hmm.
The first one is regarding an hadith that talks about if you do 4 deeds in a day, you get heaven as a reward. And one of them is following a funeral procession.
Mm.
So, is it enough that we just pray the funeral and that's it, or do we actually have to follow it, even though there's proof that says that it's disliked?
Mm.
That's the first one. The second one, can we pray istikhara on behalf of someone else?
Okay.
That's it.
Thank you, Sister Sally. Got your questions. Mashallah, very interesting questions. Okay. Sister Saba from Canada, her mother-in-law is planning on performing Hajj without a mahram, but with a group from India, and she will join them in Mecca or Medina, then they will look after her. I answered this question earlier when I said, generally speaking, and the opinion of the vast majority of the Muslim jurists, that it is not permissible for a woman to travel alone without a male mahram of her. Some of the scholars exempt women who are traveling for Hajj if they don't have a mahram and if they're traveling with a group and in a safe company. I personally prefer the opinion of the vast majority, which applies even to people who are performing Hajj. As far as your third question, it really touched my heart that she wants to perform Hajj on behalf of her father-in-law. May Allah bless you, and inshallah you'll be rewarded a great deal. Since he passed away, as you know that, you know, when people pass away, they're poor, miskin. They don't have any source of income of hasanat anymore. So when somebody volunteers, she says, because my husband is performing Hajj for the first time, she have done Hajj a couple times before. So don't worry about your reward. You will not be deprived of the reward of performing Hajj. It will be maintained, inshallah. And meanwhile, you're going to benefit your father-in-law in his grave a great deal. And I'm pretty sure your husband would definitely appreciate that. Jazakumullah khairan. May Allah accept from you. Brother Ahmed from the KSA is referring to the ayah, beautiful ayah, which I love so much, of Surah An-Nisa, in which Allah the Almighty says, إِن تَجْتَنِبُوا كَبَائِرَ مَا تُنْهَوْنَ عَنْهُ نُكَفِّرْ عَنْكُمْ سَيِّئَاتِكُمْ وَنُدْخِلْكُمْ مُدْخَلًا كَرِيمًا. And the ayah means, if you avoid the major sins which you have been forbidden against, as a result of that, we will expiate from you your minor sins. وَنُدْخِلْكُمْ مُدْخَلًا كَرِيمًا. And as a result of that, also will admit you into a noble entry. Al-Jannah, yani. Okay, so for avoiding the major sins,
One of the means of forgiving the minor sins is avoiding the major sins. And the ayah is very clear in explaining that there are major sins and minor sins. And the major sins have been explained in some ahadith. Any sin which Allah, the Almighty, have threatened those who do it, warn against its doing, whether with a punishment in this dunya or in the hereafter, that's a major sin. A sin which has a set punishment, like a had from the hudud, for stealing, for drinking, for committing adultery, that's a major sin. Other than that, there are minor sins. The major sins are said to be 70, or some of the scholars counted about 300 plus, but the rest of the sins are minor sins. What the scholars said about the minor sins, if the person insists on doing a minor sin, and he becomes addicted to it, it turns to a major sin. If the person insists on lying, so he becomes a liar, so his practice becomes a major sin. Insists of watching bad materials, it becomes a major sin. Sister Sally from Egypt asked about the beautiful hadith which says, when the Prophet ﷺ asked his companions, who gave any charity today? Abu Bakr said, me. He said, who is fasting today? Abu Bakr said, me. He said, who followed the funeral today? Abu Bakr said, me. Who visited a sick person? These are four beautiful, virtuous acts. So the Prophet ﷺ said, مَجْتَمَعْنَا فِي مْرِئٍ مُسْلِمٍ إِلَّا أَتْخَنَّهُ الْجَنَّةِ. Whenever a Muslim does these four virtuous deeds in a day, he is eligible to enter paradise. So she says that, does a person have to follow the funeral or only pray the funeral? Okay. For a woman, she doesn't have to follow the funeral. She's not supposed to follow the funeral. So if she fulfills the above three and only attends the funeral prayer, inshallah, she gets the same. Can somebody pray istikhara instead of another? No. Because the outcome is what the person feels, what the person experiences, not somebody else. But can I pray for somebody who is going through istikhara or making a decision? My sister is getting married or she has some proposals and she's praying istikhara. Can I ask Allah to guide her to the right choice? Of course, that is recommended. Brothers and sisters, we just come to the end of today's edition of Ask Huda. And until next time, I leave you all in the care of Allah. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Allah is my heart's speech, your mercy is what I beseech.